Delirium. Confusion is the same as delirium. Confusion is a change in the way you see the world and react to the world. And delirium is acute confusion. So it's a sudden change. One minute you're with it, you're talking to a person, you're making sense. The next minute you're looking over their shoulder, you're looking at the ceiling, you can't even attend to what they're asking for 2 or 3 seconds. It's that sudden change. And they're not making sense. Some people say they're away with the fairies. They're out of their tree. It's any of those descriptions, but they're very different to what is normal. Delirium is acute. It's the sudden onset of confusion. It's associated with an inability to relate to the outside world. It's associated with people not being able to hold on to a concept for more than a couple of seconds. It's often associated with hallucinations. So they're looking around. They can't attend to what they're doing. It's sudden onset. Dementia, on the other hand, is a slow, gradual impairment in a person's memory, in their thinking, in their behaviour, in their personality. It comes on over years. Delirium comes on over hours. That's the difference. A delirium is a medical emergency. We don't actually know exactly what's happening in the brain, but clearly there are major things going wrong. It's a cholinergic deficit, so a deficit of acetylcholine, but it stops the brain functioning. People die from delirium. People become disabled after delirium. They spend longer in hospital if they have a delirium. It's a very dangerous condition to have, and so we try and avoid it. There are a number of ways you can avoid delirium. The first thing is to be aware it will happen. So if someone has dementia, we say if they are unwell, expect a delirium. What you can do is make sure the person is well hydrated, that they eat, that they keep mobile, that they're not given drugs that are going to make them worse, that they've got their spectacles, they've got their hearing aid, and preferably they've got someone who's familiar with them near them. That sort of orientation makes a huge difference for someone with delirium, particularly, say, after an operation. The treatment of delirium depends on the cause. Part of the treatment is supportive, so managing the person, making sure that they're well hydrated, that they're eating, that they're sitting up in bed and not just lying, doing nothing, and then you look for the cause. There is usually a medical cause to delirium. Could be a bladder infection, could be a change in drugs, it could be drug withdrawal, can be a whole range of things, low blood oxygen. You treat that, and then you're also treating the delirium. There is a difference between hospital and home in terms of the incidence of delirium. Studies have shown that if you care for people who are very unwell in their homes, the incidence of delirium is less. Because they're in a familiar environment with familiar people, they're often better fed, they're often kept well hydrated, they have to walk to the toilet. It's a better environment for an older person to be in if they're at risk of delirium. If someone has a delirium, they can recover from it quite quickly and go back to almost normal, or they can recover very slowly, or some people don't really recover fully at all. If that happens, they're on their way then to residential care. They can't manage at home any longer. And we know that delirium is a pointer towards the need for residential care, so avoiding it is very important. Risk factors for delirium are being older, being acutely unwell, and having an underlying dementia. Being in hospital is also a risk factor for delirium. Risk factors for dementia are quite different. They're usually lifestyle factors associated with raised blood pressure and cholesterol in midlife, perhaps not enough exercise, and a family history. There's also a large number of cases of dementia that come completely unexplained. When an older person comes into hospital, into the emergency department, we want the staff to think of their mental state as one of their vital signs. So just to screen them for a delirium, and that can be done quite quickly in the emergency department. So you need to think about delirium and then screen for it. That can be done in the emergency department. Now, doing it in the wards should happen at least once a day because people vary, and you can develop delirium in the wards as well, and you can develop delirium particularly post-operatively. So we encourage, again, people to screen, to look for changes in a person's mental state after an operation. There are a number of screening tools that can be used. I think the shorter, the better, because people, staff in emergency departments are really busy anyway. Probably the tool known as SQID, single question in delirium, is the best one. It simply asks, has there been an acute change in this person's mental state in the last few hours? Simple as that. If we asked that of every person that came into the emergency department, we'd be doing well. We've really got to watch anticholinergic drugs with delirium. So these are drugs used sometimes in the treatment of Parkinson's disease. These are drugs like furosemide, which we use for cardiac failure. These are drugs like prednisone, which we use in respiratory failure. So we just have to be aware a lot of our common drugs have an anticholinergic effect. That is, they cause more confusion in an already fragile brain. A story of one of my patients more recently with a dementia who came in and had a hip replacement. She was in recovery after having had a successful hip replacement and unfortunately developed a delirium which was not picked up. She thought she heard her husband being carried off to be executed, climbed over the rails of the bed, fell and completely dislocated her just finished hip replacement. An example where post-operative delirium should have been looked for.